I have with me today one of my colleagues and one of my closest circle of friends. He comes from Australia. His name is Sheikh Wael Ibrahim, sitting on my left. He is my slightly elder brother. There is a gap of few weeks between me and him. So he's slightly older brother, but being a grandfather, I have more experience in that, inshallah. And Allah has blessed him with something unique. You know, today we have the age of pornography. The age of pornography. People are looking at dirty things. People are advertising in a dirty way. You want to sell, for example, a tire. You know, tire, Dunlop or Bridgestone. You know Bridgestone? In order to get the man to look at the quality of the Bridgestone, you need a naked lady sitting next to the tire. Are you understanding how cheap they made the women? They made a woman so cheap that they said, you must stand naked and you stand Bridgestone. When he thinks Bridgestone, he says, oh, that lady, yeah, that advert, I remember. You see? That's how the world has become. Am I right, Sheikh? So it's crazy how they are playing with the mind. We have sometimes addictions to some things. We don't even realize we are addicted to this. You see, like for example, sometimes we are addicted to jollof. We don't even realize. We need it. Without that, khalas, my stomach is still empty. Why? There was no jollof. Allah. You see. So, Brother Wael Ibrahim has specialized in something unique. To help people without prejudice, without hurt or hate, without belittlement. Anyone who is addicted and has behavioral addictions, this is where you go. They have the Aware Academy, which is also professional. It is run in a very good way. People go there. They don't make you think you are not a Muslim. I have a problem, for example. I need to say to someone who can help me, look, brother, I have this problem. If they are true leaders and true mentors, they will not judge you. They will help you. Come out of it. Come. When you are out of it, you will be a great person. So people have all these addictions. So I want him to speak to us only because, not necessarily about addictions itself, but just because Allah gives everyone an approach of addressing people. When I talk to you, me, I have my own style. You know it, isn't it? My own style. Some of the malams from here, they have their own style, isn't it? And some of them, they will scream and shout at you when you are sitting there. Am I Muslim or is there something happening here? Am I right? Some of them, they scream and shout, and some of them, they are calm. So every approach, it affects and impacts the people. So the reason why I want to ask him to speak is because inshallah he will be able to share something with an Australian flavor, with an Egyptian flavor, with a Hong Kong flavor, and with a Filipino flavor. Because his wife is Filipino. She is an amazing sister. I know her personally. His children, mashallah, they are amazing. And he's originally from Egypt. He lived in the Far East. I must tell your story. You must tell something else, inshallah. So that is my brother, and what a wonderful guy. If you know him, you will love him. So here goes Sheikh Wael, Brother Wael Ibrahim. Please give us a few good words. May Allah bless you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. Jazakumullah khair. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. I'm so glad I heard about Brother Yahya, but I don't know who Brother Yahya yet.
Who do you think is Brother Yahya from here?
I think the person next to you, but I mean nobody introduced
him.
Him,
Brother Yahya?
Is it Brother Yahya?
Mashallah.
No? Not him? No? I don't know, I heard the name. Who's he?
The one who is almost about to massage your feet.
Allahu Akbar! So, Jazakumullah khairan, may Allah bless the home, the inhabitants of the homes and everyone. Now, Mufti Mink put me on the spot as always, mashallah, barakallah fi.
It's a good spot.
Alright, the thing that I want to mention, which I believe it had a lot of impact on people, is my own personal story and how I became who I am today, from the dark side to today, to where I'm here, you know, where I'm at the moment. And that is how I started my life growing up, loving music, life, you know, the life of the nightclubs and weddings and other vices. We don't want to go into the details. But that was me before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guidance. And the reason why I always mention this story is that there are many people up until today are into these vices. Whether music, anyone into gaming? Anyone into gaming in Nigeria? No? Allahu Akbar. MashaAllah, Tabarakallah. How about movies? Don't worry, Mufti Mek will not judge you. Will you judge him, Sheikh? Anyone into movies? Yeah, songs, TV series, sitcom and whatnot. So all these things usually... Yeah, I know. All these things sometimes take us from reality and put us into that imaginary lifestyle that made us depressed about who we are and what we are experiencing and so on. So that was me back in the days. I wanted to become famous. I wanted to become, you know, admired by people and so on. Until I reached a point that I didn't have passion about anything in my life other than music and singing. I started disobeying my parents and so on. Story short, I went to Hong Kong City. I got married to a Catholic lady because I didn't care about religion at that time. And in Hong Kong City, I became even more adamant to become famous. And I ran after that singer named Leslie Cheung. And all of a sudden, in the middle of all these, you know, effort to become someone like him, he committed suicide. And that took me into a phase of depression for about 6 months. I don't recall that period in my life. Until I started to awake again. My wife told me what happened, and slowly I wanted to pray. I was on antidepressant, I was so many medications, so I just wanted to pray. The only thing that came into my mind is I wanted to pray. So as I just put something to pray on, no wudu, no direction, no qibla, nothing, I just wanted to pray.
Hasbunallah.
Wallahi, I just say I wanted to pray. So I say Allah, I remember how to pray. My parents taught us how to pray. And as I was prostrating, I remember a man back in the days, my father used to take us to the masjid, and he will literally throw us into the masjid and he will tell the man, teach them how to pray. So I remember this man, I don't know why, while I'm in prostration. Did you guys remember sometimes while we're praying we remember worldly matters, like, you know? So this too happened to me that moment. But I remember that guy who used to teach us how to pray. And he used to say, when you pray, remember the Kaaba in front of you, Jannah on your right, hellfire on your left, and the angel of death waiting for you to finish so he can take up your soul. And as I was saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, my wife was standing behind me.
Angel of death.
I thought so. And subhanAllah, my wife was very intrigued by the sujood position. And she started asking me question after question. And I was so ignorant about my own faith. But prayers had left an impact on my wife to a point that she couldn't sleep, and she asked me to pray with her. Like, she said, you teach me how the Muslim pray, but I don't want to become a Muslim. That was her condition. Just show me how you guys praying, what do you say, but I don't want to become a Muslim. I love Jesus. She used to say, Jesus, I will never betray Jesus. That was my wife. And okay, so I stood in front and she was at the back, and I start praying. And when we reach again to the sujood, I heard my wife from behind crying like a baby, like with voices and noises. And so when we finished, I thought, why were you praying? She said, God is worthy to be worshipped like this. This is how God should be worshipped. And a few days later, she took her shahada, she became a Muslim. And many weird things, many miraculous things happened actually after that. My wife started calling her mom in the Philippines. My wife is from the Philippines. And she invited her to Islam. She was telling her, you must become a Muslim. And I was like looking at my wife. I said, I should be doing what she's doing, because, you know, I'm an Egyptian Muslim. I should be doing this. And then slowly we traveled to the Philippines. Her father became a Muslim. Her brother became a Muslim. Her sister-in-law became a Muslim. Her mom became a Muslim 16 years later. And she died as a Muslim, alhamdulillah. But during those period, masjid was established in the Philippines. The whole neighborhood.
So your life changed.
Wallahi, everything, slowly, everything has changed. And then the reason why I got into studying Islam is the constant questions that my wife was, you know, asking every single day, asking me things about Islam. I didn't know anything. So I started looking into studying. Why am I telling you this personal story? Because I really hate seeing people repeating the same vicious cycle, repeating the same mistakes. I became depressed because I was running after the dunya. The guy who committed suicide that I was looking up to, he left a note, a suicidal note in his hotel room with one word. Anyone can guess what was that word? Anyone? Depression. So money, fame, all this, you know, he was titled the Asian's biggest superstar. That was his title. People will travel from all over Asia to attend his concerts and new movies and whatnot. And nothing, none of that, you know, these thrilling channels offered him anything but depression. So I don't want, I hate looking at people telling them that, be careful, life is too short. I have seen many of my friends who were in my band who died actually in drug addiction or in drug overdose in front of my very eyes. So I just thought perhaps my story can uplift somebody else, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us sincerity, and jazakumullahu khairan for the invitation. Shukran, Mufti.
MashaAllah. Barakallahu feekum.
Introduction. Thank you.